Like all other holidays rooted in pagan sun worship, Father's Day always falls on the third Sunday of June, usually falling on the day named in honor of their most powerful god, the sun. You see, it's important for us to understand that holidays are ancient pagan feasts that were ushered in by the Roman Catholic Church during the rule of Emperor Constantine. Constantine, founder of Christianity, was a pagan sun worshiper who wanted to unite his empire, both pagan and non-pagan, together. So he achieved this by rewriting history and renaming pagan feasts with different names. Early believers kept Saturday as the Sabbath until March 7th, 321 CE, when Pope Constantine passed a law requiring believers to worship on Sunday, the day the pagans worshipped the sun god. Believers still kept Saturday as the Sabbath until another law was passed 11 years later. This law, signed into decree by Pope Constantine, forbids believers to worship on the Sabbath, Saturday, and it was punishable by death by the Catholic Church. Many believers were burnt to death by the Catholic Church for keeping the Sabbath. You know what I'm saying? It shows the people's obsession with the sun, S-U-N, not the sun, S-O-N. And that's what all of these holidays are about. You know, so when somebody say that something is pagan, little Hebrews, it just means that it's the worship of the sun. Let's take worshiping these holidays for an example, which is also sin, or which is also against YAH'S laws. But we can actually say pagan to this. We can say that these holidays are pagan because it's the actual worship of the sun. So anyway, the idea to legalize an official Father's Day many years after its true celebration came to a married mother seated in a church in Washington. Attentive to a Sunday sermon on Mother's Day in 1910, 2 years after the first Mother's Day observance in West Virginia. During the sermon, which described maternal sacrifices made for children, Mrs. Dodd realized that in her own family it had been her father, William Jackson Smart, a Civil War veteran who had sacrificed raising herself and five sons alone following the early death of his wife in childbirth. Her proposal, local Father's Day celebration, received strong support from the town's ministers and members of the Spokane, Washington YMCA. The date suggested for the festivities, June 5th, Mrs. Dodd's father's birthday, were 3 weeks away. It had to be moved back to the 19th when ministers claimed they needed extra time to prepare the lessons on a new subject such as Father's Day. Remember, little Hebrews, the summer solstice is when? The summer solstice is June 21st. And remember, pagan is to worship the sun, and these people are sun worshipers. So we believers know the reason the ministers held back, because most of them know the deep satanic origin of this day, a day in which did not originate with Mrs. Dodd. But let's keep going. Interest in Father's Day increased. Father's Day, however, was not so quickly accepted as Mother's Day. Members of the all-male Congress felt that a move to proclaim the day official might be interpreted as a self-congratulatory pat on the back. Why? Why, little Hebrews? Why do you think Father's Day wasn't so readily accepted as Mother's Day? In 1916, President Woodrow Wilson and his family personally observed the day. And in 1924, President Calvin Coolidge recommended that states, if they wished, could hold their own Father's Day observances. He wrote to the nation's governors that the widespread observance of this occasion is calculated to establish more intimate relations between fathers and their children, and also to impress upon fathers the full measure of their obligations. Eventually, in 1972, 62 years after it was proposed, Father's Day was permanently established by President Richard Nixon. Historians seeking an ancient precedent for an official Father's Day observance have come up with only one. The Romans, every February, honored fathers, but only the deceased. Many people attempted to secure official recognition for Father's Day. One of the most notable efforts was made in 1957 by Senator Margaret Chase Smith, who wrote forcefully to Congress that either we honor both our parents, mother and father, or let us desist or stop from honoring either one. But to single out just one of our two parents and omit the other is the most grievous insult imaginable. Question. Why do we need to be told to do something Yah already commanded us to do? Let's go to Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Honor thy mother and father. Honor thy mother and father, and I'm reading out the KJV, that thy days may be prolonged upon the land which Yah your mighty one giveth thee. And I purposely read out the KJV because of the word honor. I like that they put honor thy mother and father, because Senator Margaret Chase Smith said the same thing when she said either we honor both our parents, but Yah already tells us to honor both our parents, so why do we need to be given permission to do so? So, we already know we are supposed to honor our mothers and fathers because Yah told us to. We don't need to take part in satanic ceremonies called holidays in order to achieve what Yah already instructed us to do. And this is why it's important to understand the root of all things, because if not, our roots will become someone else's root. Our foundation will be built on someone else's opinion instead of truth. It will be built on somebody's feelings and beliefs. You know, I feel, I believe, instead of truth. So in closing, the purpose of this lesson is to build foundation. This here is your foundation, little bros, and will help and guide you, Yah willing, in your understanding of future lessons as well as your understanding of truth when those lessons have to be physically implemented. You know, when you have to actually put them to the test, when they have to be physically applied to our lifestyle. That's the end of the lesson, Hebrews and Shebrews.